Thanks a lot for joining everyone to our today's webinar, Kubernetes Multi-Cluster Management with Rancher. This is actually the first Rancher webinar we are having together at Finis and Rancher doing so. I think there will many more will join, but this is a little introduction on, like I already said, Kubernetes Multi-Cluster Management with Rancher. And I'm very pleased today to have Rob, our DevOps engineer from the Netherlands here, and Bastian, field engineer at SUSE. Hi there. And yeah, with that, without further ado, I think I give the word to you, Bastian.
Thank you for the short introduction. Let me quickly share my screen so that you can see my slides. Should now be visible, right? And let's move that out of the way.
Perfect.
Okay. So, my name is Bastian. I'm a field engineer at SUSE. That means I support our customers or soon-to-be customers in especially running SUSE Linux, Kubernetes, Rancher, containers successfully in their infrastructure and help them introduce this in their company. And today, I want to talk about how SUSE and Rancher can help to run Kubernetes clusters in production, and especially run and provision and manage them if you have more than one cluster. And also, I want to talk a bit about why we would even want to do that. But before we go into Kubernetes and all the infrastructure and orchestration, let's step shortly one step back and have a look at why containers are actually now critical in IT, in managing systems. The latest Forrester surveys already found most developers, or 60% of the developers, already are using containers somehow, somewhere for their software deployments, for their IT infrastructure to make it easier to deploy software. On the other hand, probably only about 10% of the applications running in production somewhere in the world are currently containerized. So we definitely estimate that this quota will pick up, and also the interest in the webinar shows containers, Kubernetes, it is a hot topic. And just what Forrester expect, that the growth of containers in production in IT is gonna grow by 50% just by the end of this year. But what makes containers so great for running your applications? In short, a container allows you to package your application binaries, compile source code, the source code you need, including all dependencies that your application needs, into one image. And then you can take this one image that has everything inside that your application needs and start running it on any kind of server in a container. And the only thing this server or virtual machine needs is a container runtime. Also, to keep in mind, running an application, running a container, is not virtualization. So it's still a process that runs natively on a server. You don't have any virtualization overhead. It's just encapsulated with Linux kernel features. And being able to package your application inside of a container image and just run it everywhere where you have a container runtime allows you, as an operation team, to make it a lot easier to disconnect your apps from infrastructure dependencies, because everything is included in the image. On the infrastructure level, you only need a container runtime. And this makes your application a lot more flexible and portable and scalable. Because if you want to move your application to some other servers, to some other infrastructures, you just stop the container on one server, start it on another one. Or if you want to scale it up, you just start more containers. And if you want to scale it down, you stop containers again, and your system is clean and as if your application was never there. This also allows you to achieve a much more consistent and immutable way of operating your infrastructure, because everything is predictable. You know what's going to be started, what's happening when you start a container. You know all the versions inside of that. And also from security point of view, it makes it a lot easier to reason what is running where. And this allows you also to reduce costs a lot, because upgrading dependencies, upgrading a library, upgrading a language runtime is a lot easier, because you just have to update for your application into the container. You have to stop the old one, start the new one, and you're good to go. And all this enables application development teams to innovate a lot faster, because just all the operational overhead of running applications is easier, is less. And of course, for businesses means shorter time to market and easier to differentiate yourself, because you can spend more time on actually developing your software than to care about infrastructure. So containers are really great. And if you just have a couple containers and like two applications, you're running on three servers, it's really easy. You have your three servers, you decide which container should run where, how often, and you just start them up. And yeah, if there is an update, you stop the old version, start the new version. Fine, easy. But in reality, most environments don't look like this, and they look more like this. You not only have two applications, you probably have dozens of applications and services. Think about microservices. You also have all these auxiliary things like monitoring, logging, also all applications that you have to manage and start. And you not only have one or two servers, but probably dozens or hundreds of servers or virtual machines. And then even encapsulated containers, running them can become challenging. How do we automate all of that? Rollout, updates, stopping of containers on multiple different servers. How do we even decide which container and which application runs on which server in order to use the resources we have as efficiently as possible? And yeah, what about networking? All these applications probably have to talk with each other. How we can ensure that? How we can ensure service discovery? How can we ensure security? And configuring this all by hand can then, even if we have containers, still become a nightmare. And that's where container orchestration systems like Kubernetes step in. Because what Kubernetes allows you to do is you can install it on a set of servers, and these servers form then one Kubernetes cluster. And this Kubernetes cluster then gives you a common compute platform across all your infrastructure, across all your servers, which you can use to deploy your containers upon. And you can install Kubernetes and use it from anything from your developer laptop, maybe there in a small virtual machine to test stuff out, to your own data center, to the cloud, but even in edge scenarios like a 5G cell tower, like a windmill in a wind park, like maybe the cashier system in a store or some industry PCs in a factory, wherever you actually need to deploy software you can run Kubernetes. And then also with Kubernetes, you have the possibility to standardize the differences and provide a common API to deploy your software on all these different infrastructures. And Kubernetes not only allows you to have an API that you can just point your containers to, and then Kubernetes will start and stop and deploy them somewhere. Kubernetes then cares also about all the additional stuff you need to actually run them productively. Things like health checks, load balancing, network setup and service discovery, security policies, role-based access control, scaling, backup and recovery, like all the day two operational stuff you need to actually get your services and applications and containers running in production. So Kubernetes is great. Let's talk a bit more about on the edge. What actually does it need to run Kubernetes on the edge? Historically, Kubernetes was made for the cloud and the data center. It is very powerful. It gives you a lot of features. It is also a very scalable and stable system, but it was made for environments where resources are not that much of a problem. That doesn't mean that Kubernetes needs like gigabytes and tens of gigabytes of memory. but it was made in a way that it is a distributed system, Kubernetes itself, and it was made for that. That means when you run Kubernetes, there is, of course, the bit of operational overhead to run Kubernetes, and especially Kubernetes in a highly available way, which does not translate so well to edge scenarios where you have only limited resources. Think about like a windmill in a wind park. There is some server in there, like probably one. Maybe it's even an ARM server, a Raspberry Pi even. You want to deploy some software there to actually see and monitor that your windmill is still running correctly, that you probably can influence it from the outside. And Kubernetes is a great way for that. But installing Kubernetes on such a restricted environment can be actually quite complex because of the way how Kubernetes was designed and architectured. Because of the nature of Kubernetes, you have to manage the storage of Kubernetes itself, certificates for all the different components. Then it's multiple services that you have to start up for Kubernetes. And you also have to ensure that it's all configured consistently in an environment that is restricted. And that's the reason why we decided, okay, we as Rancher and SUSE, we have to make this easier. And we created a specialized Kubernetes distribution called K3S. K3S is a complete Kubernetes distribution that is combined into a single Kubernetes binary. And this binary embeds everything you need for Kubernetes, the container runtime, Kubernetes itself, the storage of Kubernetes, as well as all the different plugins and tools you need for networking, DNS, service discovery, storage, and so on. So it is very opinionated. Of course, all components are swappable, and K3S is great to run as a single instance, but you can also, of course, run it fully highly available on multiple of servers. Important, while it is opinionated, the distribution itself is completely certified by the Cloud Native Computing Foundation to be standard compliant. So it makes K3S is a lot easier to install on a server, especially if you have restrictions in how much CPU memory you have. But from a usage point of view, when you want to use the Kubernetes API and the Kubernetes tooling to deploy your containers, to set up networking and so on, it behaves exactly like any other Kubernetes cluster. And also, K3S is not only easy to install because everything is included in a single binary and you just have to start it up. Because of this being included into a single binary, there's also a lot of optimizations in there that reduce the amount of CPU and memory you need to run a Kubernetes cluster control plane by a lot. So usually you can get away with something like 500 megs of RAM for the whole complete Kubernetes control plane. And that makes it actually usable also on small Raspberry Pis, ARM devices, industry PCs, and so on. So K3S is a really nice way to run a single Kubernetes cluster very efficiently, especially in restricted environments, but also on the server in the cloud. But especially in edge scenarios, you not only have one cluster, you probably have more. Because you not only have one windmill in a wind park, you probably have hundreds of thousands. You have in a supermarket chain, you have lots of stores. And even in a more traditional environment where you say you have your 1-2 data centers, you probably also will have a cluster for production. You have one for staging. You have one for development and testing. Maybe you have even multiple development clusters for different teams so that they don't influence each other negatively. And maybe you also have multiple production clusters because you are spread out globally and you have one cluster in North America and one in Europe in different data centers. So there are tons of reasons why you're going to have more than just one Kubernetes cluster. And managing one Kubernetes cluster is usually quite fine and works well. There's even the out-of-the-box Kubernetes tooling is good for that. But if you need to manage more, and especially if you need to manage not only 1, 2, 3, but then thousands of clusters, even provisioning all these Kubernetes clusters, keeping them up to date, setting up authentication and authorization, policies, monitoring, logging can become quite a burden. And that's where Rancher comes in. Rancher is a multi-cluster Kubernetes management tool that you can use to manage everything from one to tens of thousands of Kubernetes clusters from a single central management interface. And you can use Rancher then to provision completely new clusters, to upgrade them, to keep them up to date, to also delete them, of course, on any kind of infrastructure in the data center, in the cloud, and on the edge. And then you can use it not only to provision and see them, but also to set up authentication with an enterprise authentication system, security policies in a central way, and set up things like integrated monitoring, logging, service measures, all from one central interface. And even on top of that, you not only can manage the cluster and all these additional tooling, you can also use Rancher to directly manage all your applications and containers running inside of the clusters from a central UI. So in an architecture here, a diagram, it will look like this. You have the central Rancher management server, and then down connected to it, you have everything from one to tens of thousand individual Kubernetes clusters on different infrastructures in different sizing with different versions that you can connect to it. And with that, we also have been quite successful with the product. So Rancher is actually the most and widely adopted enterprise Kubernetes management platform with over 100 million downloads and over 30,000 active deployments that we know of. There are probably a lot of ones that we don't know of because they are running somewhere in an air-gapped high security environment without internet connectivity. And we also have over 400 enterprise customers that we help with our enterprise support to run then Rancher and Kubernetes and containers successfully. And yeah, we are also very active in the open source community, in the Cloud Native Computing Foundation, there as a founding member and governing board, have partnerships with all the big infrastructure and cloud providers. And just if we also have a look at what our customers are, it is everything out from all different verticals, all different industries. We have customers running Kubernetes and Rancher. From financial services, over technology, government services, telcos, retail manufacturing, media companies, and all over the world. So in the Americas, in Europe, in Asia, in Africa, in Australia, lots of different logos. And to give you a bit of more introduction, a bit more feeling how it looks like, I want to spend a couple minutes just showing you the Rancher management server and what it feels like and what you can do with it. So here you see the Rancher management server web UI. And of course, everything that is available here in the web UI can also be completely automated. There is an API behind this. You can automate this with Ansible, Terraform, or the tooling of your choice. So you don't have to click it, but it's nice to have a web UI to be able to quickly see your environment and manage it. And from this central management interface, I then can start adding new clusters. So I can say, hey, I want to add a new Kubernetes cluster. And I can then add clusters either by importing any kind of existing Kubernetes cluster that I have provisioned elsewhere with other tooling. Or more interesting, I can directly from this interface create new Kubernetes clusters. Either by creating a new Kubernetes cluster on some servers or some virtual machines that are already provisioned somewhere. And then I get an installation command from Rancher that I can now execute on a naked Linux server. And then I get a Kubernetes cluster on top of it. Or I can even connect Rancher to any kind of infrastructure or cloud provider that has an API. So that could be AWS, Azure, DigitalOcean, but or the Oracle Cloud, but also it could be infrastructure providers that run on-premise in your own data center, things like a VMware vSphere or an OpenStack. And this is actually a plug-in system. So this list is not complete. You can activate and install additional plugins to connect additional infrastructure providers. And what Rancher can then do is, if it has a connection to such an infrastructure provider, I can give Rancher access to this infrastructure provider, provide a username, password, or API tokens. And then when I, for example, want to create a cluster at DigitalOcean, I can say, hey, Rancher, please create me a new Kubernetes cluster. And please create me at this infrastructure provider at DigitalOcean the necessary VMs, virtual machines, for my Kubernetes cluster. So for example, I can say, hey, I want to have two pools of nodes in my cluster, one for my Kubernetes control plane, one for my Kubernetes worker nodes for my own containers. And I may want to have three control plane nodes and maybe five worker nodes. And then I can choose from which template Rancher should create these virtual machines at this infrastructure provider. And these templates I created beforehand to just save a bit of time. It basically has the information, how can I and where can I authenticate against DigitalOcean in this case? And how should the VMs look like? How much CPU, how much memory, how much disk space, and which operating system I'm choosing for these virtual machines. So I could, for example, say the control plane node should come from this template, the worker nodes from this template. And I can create as many node pools as I want with different roles here. And of course, later on, I also can remove node pools or scale them up and down to scale my cluster however I need it. And next, I can choose the Kubernetes version I want to deploy. I can set up networking, and then I can set up things like a private registry for air-gapped setups. I can configure backup and disaster recovery, update strategies, and everything I need in a Kubernetes cluster. And if I click Create, Rancher will now connect to DigitalOcean, boot up the VMs, install container runtime, install Kubernetes, and in like 2-3 minutes, I have a completely new Kubernetes cluster array. What I can then do, if I have a Kubernetes cluster, I can now connect my authentication system to Rancher centrally. So things like an Active Directory, LDAP, SAML-based single sign-on systems. Here I chose a GitHub organization as an authentication source. And then if I did this, I have all my users and all my groups from this authentication system available in my central Rancher system. And then centrally, I can give these users and groups permissions to either have role permissions to do something centrally, globally, inside of Rancher. For example, the permission to create new clusters. Or I could also say, hey, you user or you group should not be able to create new clusters, but I give you permissions to manage individual clusters and give you permissions in them, or even not only access to complete clusters, but maybe just to a couple of projects inside of a cluster so that I can have a completely role-based access control multi-tenancy system. And very granularly can say these users and these groups should have these permissions for these workloads and these applications running in these clusters. And the great thing is I can set this up all centrally. I can configure all the roles, map these to my users, and then of course also visualize these centrally to see this user has these global permissions and these permissions in these clusters and these permissions in these projects in these clusters. So I can set this up centrally, I can audit it centrally, and then Rancher will update and roll it out to all individual clusters. And if I have access to a cluster, let's maybe go into this one that I already prepared beforehand. I can not only, if I have access to it, I can see, of course, a bit of meta information, how my cluster is doing, how much CPU and memory I have available. I can also see all the servers and nodes in my cluster. I can also click on them and see a couple more details about what is happening on my nodes, what their status is, how all the health checks of the nodes are doing. But I can even dive deeper inside of this cluster and go inside of this cluster explorer and then have a look, if I have access to it, to all the workloads running in my cluster. And here you can see I have a small shop project, and I can see all the Kubernetes deployments with all the containers. I see the images. I can quickly, for example, go to my front end deployment here. I see my Kubernetes pods and containers running inside of here. I see their IP addresses, their status. I see which image they are running. I can quickly, if I will need to do some debugging, have a look at the live logs of this container. I can, for debugging, open an interactive shell directly from the interface, if I have the permissions to do so, directly inside to the container, which is very nice for debugging. And of course, I can also directly edit this deployment. And instead of having now to learn the in and outs of the Kubernetes API and the Kubernetes YAML manifest to configure everything, I get actually a nice form that I can use to, for example, add new environment variables, configure health checks, configure everything that Kubernetes can do. And I cannot only edit new applications, new deployments for my containers, I also can create new ones. For example, I can say, hey, I want to create a new Nginx deployment based on an Nginx container image. I maybe want to open up port 80. I could set up volumes, scheduling decisions, or I can just say, leave this all to default, create it. And a couple seconds later, I will have an Nginx running in addition in my cluster. And I can not only do this for individual containers and deployments, but also for all other objects that Kubernetes knows and all other configurations that Kubernetes knows. Things like security policies, secrets for database passwords, routing rules, access control, cron jobs, everything that Kubernetes can do, I can edit through this UI and visualize through this UI. And even further, Rancher not only allows you to create and interact with Kubernetes individually on the individual resource level, I also have access to a complete application store that out of the box comes with a couple of applications that we provide to enhance your cluster, for example, with monitoring capabilities, with logging capabilities, with a service mesh like Istio. It also directly comes out of the box with applications that can enhance your cluster that come from our partners. For example, Datadog, Instana, Artifactory, Nutanix, all our partners that we're working together to make it easier to integrate their solutions with your Kubernetes clusters in Rancher. But you can also here add your own application repositories or any kind of other third-party application repository to then also make additional applications available that people can install with one click. And I can, as a user of this cluster, can just go in here, for example, say I want to install CockroachDB. I get a bit of information there. I can choose where I want to install it in. I can configure it. For example, how much storage I want to give this database, let's take a bit less. And if I click on install, then a complete CockroachDB database cluster will be now installed inside of my cluster. Let's close this. This is going to be running in the background. Of course, if a new version comes in, I will also get a new notification in here, and I can directly upgrade them. And one last thing I want to show you is what you can also do in such an interface with the Rancher applications, like monitoring or logging. These applications not only install a complete monitoring stack inside of the cluster, but they also enhance the Rancher management UI with additional sections. And for example, by just installing this monitoring application, without doing any configuration changes, and without having to do anything else, I get a new monitoring section inside of the UI that gives me direct access to a fully pre-configured Prometheus in Grafana stack. And this Prometheus in Grafana stack comes out of the box with tons of metrics and data and dashboards that show me how my cluster is behaving, how much CPU, memory, disk space I'm actually using in my cluster, but also not only how my cluster is behaving, but also how my nodes are doing that are inside of my cluster, or even how individual workloads are doing that run inside of my cluster. So I could, for example, have a look at my shop project here and at the front end application and containers that you were just seeing. And I can now see the CPU usage, the memory usage, network IO, everything in ready-made dashboards. And the same is true not only for these dashboards and visualizing all this data that automatically comes in. I even get a huge set of alerts directly pre-configured that show me then that can alert me if anything goes wrong inside of my cluster, either with the cluster itself or with any kind of applications. For example, if a pod is crashing or a cron job is failing, I can get directly alerts to it. And of course, this is not only, I can not only have the things in there that are out of the box, I can also completely customize this with adding additional services that should be scraped from monitoring metrics data, or with configuring where my alerts should go to which channel, and also, of course, I can add additional dashboards and so on. And the same is not only true for the monitoring, but also for things like logging, service meshes, and everything, continuous delivery, and everything else that is directly integrated into Ratchet. And with that, I would like to finish my short presentation and demo about what Rancher is doing. And Rob will take over and show you a bit more detail on how you actually can set this up and use it.
Great. Thanks. What a great demo. Well to see. Good to see, actually. I've got a small presentation prepared on bootstrapping your first Rancher cluster. So let me share my screen as well. There we go. So you can follow along if you want to. This presentation can be found on the website here, and the QR code immediately goes to this presentation, so you can check it out later. There's a few links in here, so likely it's wise to open it up yourself and have a look. And by the way, this is Reveal MD, this presentation, and with space you navigate through it. I would say it's a really nice tool too. Could run in containers, by the way. I work for Adfinis. Adfinis is a company that helps customers in their open source engagements, typically. We're very well aware of open source stuff. And Rancher came to me a year ago or so, and I was so impressed and really like it. So that I also want to sort of share that with you. My name is Robert de Bock. I am a father of three. I live in Breukelen in the Netherlands, so it's quite locked down here. And my whole career was basically Linux. So I love it. I understand it, and it's great. When I first saw Rancher, I was like, "What? How could we use that?" And indeed, Bastian showed you a bit. And I think for us specifically, we could use it in two use cases. Likely more, because we really like the product. But for now, I see two use cases. First one is this. On the left-hand side, you see Adfinis, where we would run Rancher, and we would manage Kubernetes clusters for customers of ours. So that could be one use case, and a customer would probably just use that single cluster. And for us, that would be very easy to create new clusters or new customers in our case, and also to manage them, to expand them or reduce them or upgrade them. And I think another way it could be where we would install Rancher on-premise or so, or for a customer himself, if he or she needs to manage many more clusters. I think one of the strong points of Rancher is that it's just gotten so easy to make a new cluster that companies are starting to learn this, where they used to have, let's say, a DTAP cluster or a limited set of clusters at least. It's now so easy to spin up a new cluster. It's well worth it. It's fully isolated, no interference with each other. So it's nice. It's really quick and good. We note for most customers, they want to buy stuff or have something that's cool. And Rancher's absolutely on that list of cool stuff. But we also notice that customers are sometimes not ready for it. So we have this cloud readiness journey. It's a 1 hour workshop, basically, to understand where you are and understand where we are and where we should grow to or so. So it's a fun thing. It's only an hour. Well worth it to subscribe there. So follow the link on the Ready and you'll see it, or search for cloud readiness at Finis. So a bit of a demo. So Bastian showed you a running cluster, and I'd like to show you how to set up that first cluster, so how to bootstrap that. It's a minimal example, so it's probably not production ready or so, but at least gives you the opportunity to play with it. The code I use to spin up this stuff is at the end of this presentation. So yeah, you could use it yourself or try or experiment with it. Let's go to terminal. So I started one machine on DigitalOcean. Make it a bit bigger. Yeah, a single machine on DigitalOcean, and it needs to be resolvable. That's why I ran it on DigitalOcean. I started the experiment, let's say, a year ago or so, on my own computer, running Docker, localhost, and I couldn't understand why it all didn't work. The host needs to be resolvable. The machines it spins up need to connect back to Rancher, of course. And it's quite well documented. It's not that it's hidden or so. I just didn't read the manual, apparently. Let me steal some commands to start it up. So what we're going to do is run a single container, the Rancher container, and open up a few ports and give it some permissions. So copy paste, and I've already stolen this from Rancher. It's super, super easy, actually. So you'll see Docker download Rancher. It's a pretty big container, a gigabyte, because it probably contains everything. Not a big issue. You don't have to restart this or redo this every day or so. It's just one off. So there it is. And it's probably running. We can follow the logs. It's quite chatty. Let me move it up, by the way. So it's quite chatty, as you can see. And probably by now it's ready. So let's have a look. Sorry. Probably I've got it in my browser cache. I haven't. Well, probably need to wait a bit. Yeah, exactly. It's I still want to visit this website. Yes. Are you sure? Yes, I am very, very sure. So there it comes. So Rancher started up, and it needs some kind of a password here. So I'll give it a very simple one in this case. Can I override that? Hello, no. Oh, sorry, let me reduce that a bit. Don't use it, use a simple one for this case. And I need to agree a few things. Okay, I don't save it. So this is where it clearly says all nodes in your cluster will need to be able to reach this one. But for me, I missed that first time, so I was struggling, and now it works on a public machine. Doesn't have to be on the internet. You can also have it in your network, of course. at least the machines that you are going to spin up, or Rancher is going to spin up for you, need to be able to reach this URL, this machine. So some messages, and there's nothing here yet. Let me make it a bit smaller so I can probably understand a bit better where I am. So we need to configure a few things, not too many, but one of them is some cloud credentials. So Bastian opened up DigitalOcean, but there's probably details in Rancher how he connects. So in this case, we're going to connect it to DigitalOcean by adding a cloud credential. And indeed, as Bastian told, there's multiple there. There's not just one, so you can use more. And it's a plugin system. Did know that, Bastian, so that's a great hint. Now I need to paste this token, and I'm not sure if I saved it in the, let's just hope it's the right one. Otherwise, I have to stop sharing for a moment, copy, paste stuff, and be done with it. This credential is actually at Finisys, at Finis. So you could have more. No, I need to copy paste the token. So give me 30 seconds or so to stop sharing and start sharing again. Hold on. Got it. And share again. There we are. A bit shorter, hopefully better. Create. So it actually went out to DigitalOcean, verifying that the token I have created is valid, and now I can start to use it. Bastian showed you how to create a cluster, and he picked a few sizes for that. And that's called node templates. So you need one or more node templates. Let's add one. And indeed, Rancher itself is, the control plane and etcd are pretty light. So you could use pretty small machines. The workers, yeah, the bigger they are, the less overhead, but also the more expensive. So probably find a good balance in there. So I'm close to Amsterdam, actually very close. Let's use for the etcd and control plane, the default one, 2 gigs, a couple of CPUs, probably good enough. I guess newer is always better. So let's try Ubuntu 20. And it needs a name somewhere. So let's, just as Bastian had, let's name it something that refers to the size. So it's just easy to figure out what this thing is. CPU, something. So in a moment when we will create a cluster, you get to see this label basically. Create. Now for the workers, it's probably nice to have a bit of a bigger one. So let's see, Adfinis is paying, so I could go very big, but let's choose something, maybe 64 gigs. That's pretty good, 32 CPUs. Let's use Ubuntu again and give it, that's not in New York. Closer, please, yes. So 64 GB, 400 GB. This name, of course, you can make of it what you want, but probably a name like this is pretty logical. You maybe could use small, medium, large or something, but what is small and what is large? So we now have the templates available, which means we can start to add a cluster. So let's create one. And this is what you've already seen from Bastian. Let's go over it once more. I'll call this my cluster. And let's call this one cp-etcd minus, and Rancher will add a 0, 1, 2, 3, etc. A couple of them. And let's add workers. Let's just use one now. The worker, we wanted to use the big one, but for etcd in the control plane, the small one is good enough. And indeed, you can set a whole lot of options here. In this case, for the minimum example, this is probably already good enough. So this spinning up takes a moment. don't worry. So in the beginning, you're probably clicking and searching and why is it not working and it's provisioning, why is it so slow and so on. Give this a couple of minutes and then we'll be up and running. I guess indeed, like Bastian said, 5 minutes, maybe 10, probably depends a bit on the size. And as you can see later on, probably not click it right now, but you can simply expand the cluster by clicking a few buttons. Rancher is quite, the API for Rancher is very strong. So you could automate everything. And at least this setup is, for us, it's automated as well. No, not gonna wait, but this, yeah, a couple of minutes and then it'll be there. Let me go back to the presentation and I've got some fallback slides here, but we've seen it live, so that's good. But at least you can follow along if you want to do this yourself. And yeah, that's about it. Huh? That's pretty good. So as you can see, it's super easy to experiment. Eh? So make a cluster, it's now minutes or so. And make 10 clusters, maybe 10 minutes. So very brief. If you automate it, probably back to a minute. So a whole Kubernetes cluster just became a click of a button. And I think that's really, really surprising. In this demo, it's probably not the best practices. Eh? So it works and it's fun to play with. It's probably not production ready. And I also, as a sort of a present, what I really like, Rancher has a great lab and you can try it yourself. I'll open it up briefly. You can become a certified Rancher operator by just following this. It's free and it says here it's 5 weeks. I think that's a realistic time amount if you spend a couple of hours per week. And it goes into all kinds of details. There's also an exam at the end, if you want to, of course. If you just want to learn, that's fine too. And I think the quality of that course is absolutely worth it. So tip from my side. And the code for this whole experiment, you can open it up and follow along if you want to. It's all written here. So it's a bit of Terraform to spin up that first machine where we logged into with SSH and ran Docker. And a bit of Ansible code to at least start that container. So now we did that manually. In the code, it's automated. And then you have a blank Rancher machine where you can try and experiment and see what works for you. So hope that helps you a bit in setting up your own bootstrapping experiment, Rancher experience. That's it for me. Let's go. I saw some questions coming up. Let me stop sharing in the chat. And I think Janis or Livia, you probably will take over now.
Yeah, exactly. Thanks a lot, guys. Very, very well done. And thanks for the two demonstrations within 45 minutes without any hiccups, which is quite impressive, how I think. And we did get two questions. Both are from Eduardo. His first one is, and Claudio already answered that one, but maybe you can elaborate a little bit on it. He's asking, how opinionated is Rancher? If he already has an existing Kubernetes cluster, would he be able to manage them with Rancher without rebuilding? What do you guys can say about that? Maybe you, Bastian?
Yes, absolutely. You can manage any kind of Kubernetes cluster that is standard compliant. You can just import existing ones. If you create new ones from the UI, Rancher will use its own Kubernetes distribution for it. But you, if you have existing ones, you can just import them. And maybe I can just directly talk about the follow-up questions on that from Eduardo. If you import or if you create a cluster from Rancher, it's actually just a standard compliant vanilla Kubernetes cluster. And the only thing that is special for Rancher inside of there is that Rancher deploys a small agent inside of the cluster. And this agent then connects back to the Rancher management server. And if you can, at any point in time, you can also remove this agent again, and then you have a normal vanilla Kubernetes cluster again. So you can, it's very easy to install Rancher and use it and import your clusters in it, as you saw. But it's also as easy to get rid of it again if you say, huh, I don't need it or I don't want it anymore. And not only if you want to get rid of it, but it also means if at any point of time, if you're just running it, something happens, for example, Rancher crashes, or maybe you run it in a different data center and the connectivity is not there, your actual Kubernetes clusters continue to run. They have their own control plane. You can still access this, not through Rancher then, but through the command line, through the Kubernetes API. And also, most importantly, your containers and workloads also continue to run, even if Rancher as a central management system is not there. So you don't have like a single point of failure. You have a very lightweight connection there between the management and the clusters itself.
Cool stuff. Is that, Eduardo, I hope your questions are answered. And if not, feel free to, thanks, perfect. You just wrote, great. Cool, thanks. And Lucas, to your question, yes, we will share the link to the presentations and the recordings, of course. You should get everything afterwards, maybe, if not today, tomorrow. And Rob also asked a question. I think you can just ask that.
Let me read it. So, Bastian, that you showed me that demo there. Is that demo site available to the public, basically? Is it open?
No, it's not. It's just our internal demo system. As you showed, it is easy to set up a Rancher server. If you don't do it by best practices, you can just run a Docker container. It's of course not highly available, and we would recommend to set it up in a highly available way, also so that Rancher is not dependent on one single server. But if for just testing, just start the Docker container, fine. It takes like a few minutes. Thanks. And you can run it basically everywhere.
Cool. And we got another question. Oops, it's now just closed the window. Oh, here we are. Heinrich was asking regarding the monitoring stack, can you adjust the access to metrics and dashboard to a subset of your users? Are there data sources protected as well?
Currently, you can only do this on the cluster level. So you can, within any cluster, in every cluster, decide who should have access to it or not. But as soon as someone has access to the monitoring system, they see all metrics from all workloads within this one cluster. We are thinking about how to best do this in a way that you maybe can limit this and say, okay, only certain metrics should be visible to certain users. The big challenge there is that actually Prometheus itself does not have any kind of access control system inside of it. So we have to build something around it. One option you could do now, of course, already you could say for every group of users, you can have a dedicated Prometheus that only scrapes the monitoring data that should be visible, and then maybe have use Prometheus Federation to still have a central one that has all monitoring data. So there are ways around this, or there are ways to do this already. Also, of course, doesn't come with a click. You have to configure a couple more things. It is possible. And it depends on how to do this best a bit on your infrastructure and on your needs and on your processes. Yeah, or you give just every team their own cluster. That's of course also possible.
I hope your question is answered, Heinrich. And if not, yeah, just feel free to reach out. And I think
maybe also one good quick and Claudio just brought this up to me that I shouldn't forget about this. So thanks for that. Is if you are familiar with Terraform, we also offer. I should then post this to all, not only to Claudio. We also offer Terraform modules for all the big cloud providers to quickly set up a virtual machine, including, you should see now here my browser, right? Including Rancher and configure everything, also not in a highly available way, so it's also just for evaluation purposes, but with one Terraform command you can set up on AWS, on Azure, on Google Cloud, on DigitalOcean, or even on Vagrant VMs on your local system if you use Vagrant. So this can also be a nice way to quickly start up an evaluation system.
Cool. And Lucas just pasted the link to Rob's slide in the chat, which is great. Thanks a lot for that. And the slides from Bastian we will also provide you guys as soon as possible. So if there are no further questions, I'd like to thank you all a lot for coming today. And of course, Rob and Bastian for your great presentation, and hope to see you soon. Nice one. Stay safe, everyone.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.